أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. كذب الصمود بطغواها إذ انبعث أشقاها فقال لهم رسول الله ناقة الله وسقياها فكذبوه فعقروها فدمدم عليهم ربهم بذنبهم فسواها ولا يخاف عقباها. صدق الله العظيم. One thing I told you before is that from Suratul Muzammil till the end of the Quran, all these surahs are in perfect pairs. But at some places you'll find two pairs can be grouped together to make a subgroup. And this is the first example. Suratul Shams and Suratul Layl, they are a pair. Suratul Duha and Suratul Inshirah, they are a pair. But all four of them go to make a subgroup. There is one subject which develops gradually in these four surahs. I told you that in Suratul Shams, there are eight ayat of oath. But the reality or the statement on which these oaths have been taken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَخْشَاهَا وَالسَّمَاءِ وَمَا بَنَاهَا وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا طَحَاهَا وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. Now that statement comes, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Verily, the one who purifies his soul is successful. And the one who buries it in dust is unsuccessful. Now, we have been translating this tazkiya by the word purification. Actually, it's very hard to translate many fundamental terms of Quran into some one word of English language. It's very difficult. Tazkiyah doesn't mean only purification. It means purifying something in order that it should develop. This word, you know, is applied by the Arabs, Bedouin Arabs, to the function of a gardener. When he enters his garden, some of the plants he has himself sowed, either for flowers or for fruit. But around those plants he finds grass has grown up, other unwanted vegetation is there. So what's the result? Whatever is the nourishment in the soil is now shared by this also. It's not all going to the plant which you have sown. In the same way, the oxygen from the air that is also being shared. So he removes all these things. This is called tazkiyah, because they are hampering the growth of that plant which he has sown in order that it should grow up, be mature, bear either fruits or flowers. So man actually is a plant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has planted it. And he wants to see it flourishing, growing. But what type of growth? Not the growth of an animal. His growth as vice student of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who reflects the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his personality. So this process, to remove all the hindrances in the way of the spiritual development of a human being, which is tazkiyah. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Only that one is successful who has really purified his soul, developed his soul, his ana, his khudi. Which Allama Iqbal calls tamir-e khudi, construction of yourself. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. And I told you, دَسَّا يَدُسُّ, in Arabic means to bury something in the sand. This, you know, came in Quran for those Arab Bedouins who used to bury their female child's daughters alive. أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ. He kept on thinking, should I keep him, keep her with me, despite this humiliation, or I should bury her. See, دَسَّا يَدُسُّ. This is it. وَمَنْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. If you can't take care of that real self of yours, and you are only taking care of the animal self of yours, the animal aspect of your existence, then this animal existence of yours becomes like a grave in which that spirit is buried. Only this grave is mobile, it is moving. It's not fixed at one place. But every human being then becomes a mobile grave of his real spiritual identity and self. Now this regards mainly personal and individual purification and development of the ego or development of the self. But now we come to the collective level, human society. This also behaves in the same way. If there is no arrangement of a purification of that society and that nation, that people, that community, it is doomed. So a process has to continue, which we call Amr bil Ma'ruf Nahi anil Munkar. At the collective level, this enjoining upon people whatever is good and forbidding them from whatever is wrong, it is actually the purification of the society. This process has to continue if this society is to live as a healthy society. If this process comes down, then the society is doomed. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a devastating chastisement and they are finished. So one example, all you know, the messengers of Allah who came, they were doing this. Purifying, trying to purify the nation, purifying the society, purifying the community from the evils and ills, moral ills, or, you know, transgressions against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if they failed, actually they didn't fail, the society or the community or the nation failed. Then a devastating chastisement of Allah came and they were destroyed. One example is quoted here. كَذَّبَتْ سَمُودُ بِتَهْوَاهَا. The Samud belied the truth in their insurgence and transgression. Hazrat Salih alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to them. But this nation failed. إِذِمْ بَعْسَ أَشْقَاهَا. Now to cut a long story short, well, you know that she camel was given to them as a very big sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at their demand. But then, you know, one of the chiefs who was the most wicked, most wretched chief, he rose up to kill the she camel. فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نَاقَةَ اللَّهِ وَسُقِيَاهَا. The messenger of Allah warned them, beware, it's the camel of Allah, it's the she camel of Allah. Don't touch it. لَا تَمَسُّوهَا بِسُوءٍ. At another place we have read. نَاقَةَ اللَّهِ وَسُقِيَاهَا. And you know, keep the stern of drinking water. Don't touch it with any bad intention. But فَكَذَّبُوهُ فَعَقَرُوهَا. But then they belied him. and killed her. فَدَمْدَمَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِذَنْبِهِمْ So their Lord crushed them for their sin. فَسَوَّاهَا And levered them to the ground. Or another meaning is, made them all equal. What does it mean? There were rich, there were poor, there were the leaders, there were the fled, common people. But when this chastisement comes, you know, then all are equally involved in it, inflicted by it, afflicted by it. So we have that ayah in Suratul Anfal. وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاسَّةً Beware of that chastisement that comes, if it comes, then not only those who are involved actually in these sins, not only they are punished, others are also punished. Because they were guilty of not purifying their society. At only one place we find in Suratul Araf, those who till the last end, go on. يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ They continue their struggle to enjoin upon whatever is good and to forbid people from whatever is wrong. They are saved only. Otherwise, whether people were actually involved in that sin or not, both are included in the collective chastisement that comes. Now a little distraction here. This role that was being played by the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has now by assigned after the institution of prophethood and messengerhood having come to an end in the person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This role has been assigned collectively to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For all times to come for the whole of humanity. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفَ وَتَنْهَوْنَا لِلْمُنْكَرَ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ If we don't perform that duty, then we are doomed. Then we deserve the chastisement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رحمتیں ہیں تیری اغیار کے کاشانوں پر اور برف گرتی ہے تو بیچارے مسلمانوں پر why? We deserve it. You are not doing your job. You have become just a nation like the other nations of the world. You are rather humiliated nation, having no respect in the committee of the nations. Nobody asks you any opinion in any international matter. Kasnamipur sir ke bhaiya ki isti who you are. Nobody asks you. Zoribat alayhimu zillatu wal maskanatu wa ba'u bi ghadabi min Allah. Now from this collective doom, only those people can hope salvation and saving by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who exert up to their utmost in discharging this duty of amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar. Only they can hope. That is why we have found that ayah also in the same surah Al Imran. وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَدْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ Only these people who keep engaged in this three-item agenda, calling mankind to good, يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ and joining upon them whatever is good, وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ and forbidding them from whatever is wrong. Whosoever continues, whether someone listens or not, they don't worry. They don't have to worry. They have to discharge their duty. But they can earn salvation for them, at least, for themselves. أُولَٰئِكَهُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ وَلَا يَخَافُ عُقْبَاهَا The last ayah, Allah doesn't fear its consequences. You know, it happens in collective affairs. Supposing there is a king and he sees some of his chieftains or some of his subordinates, he is doing something wrong. But if he is, if I touch him, if I bring him to book, there might be a big turmoil. He has supporters. So he has to think twice. As we have read in Suratul Mumin, Fir'aun couldn't do anything. He wanted to kill Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. But when that, a moment from Ali Fir'aun stood up and he gave that sermon. No, he couldn't do. Although he was the person claiming to be God. Ana Rabbukumul A'la. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cares for none. وَلَا يَخَافُ عُقْبَاهَا. He doesn't have to fear that there can be rebellion, there can be some, you know, untoward results, unpleasant things might happen. No, no, he can do whatever he likes. He devastated and destroyed the whole nations. And he doesn't have to fear that something wrong can appear. Now Suratul Lail. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والليل إذا يخشى والنهار إذا تجلى وما خلق الذكر والأنثى إن سعيكم لشتى صدق الله العظيم. By the night, when it covers the whole world and shrouds in darkness, والنهار إذا تجلى, and by the day, when it shines and brightens. وَمَا خَلَقَ الزَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْسَى. And by him who created the male and the female, or by the male and female, and the way he created them. This ayah, as I told you twice in Suratul Shams, this can be translated in two ways. Now there are two sets, day, night, opposing each other. In the same way, male, female, different, opposite sexes. In the same way, إِنَّ سَعْيَكُمْ لَشَتَّى. The result of what you are doing is going to be different. Everybody is striving and working hard from morning till evening. Someone is, when he returns home in the evening, in addition to being tired and exhausted, he has brought a big load of sins also with him. A big load of divine chastisement also. The other one is, he also labored and worked, but he brought home forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the exact translation of a hadith. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every human being, when it is morning for him, till evening, فَبَايِعُ النَّفْسَهُ. He sells himself. Someone is selling his physical energy, working. Someone is selling his mental faculty, his intelligence, some technical know-how, and so on and so forth. You are selling yourself from morning till evening. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ يَغْدُو فَبَايِعُ النَّفْسَهُ. But the result is different. Someone comes home with a big load of sins also. He remained involved in haram, in interest, in usury, in gambling, in telling a lie, and this thing and that thing. And someone comes home, mu'taquha. He has got his neck freed from the fire of the hell. So these are the two destinations to which you can go. Now, إِنَّ سَعْيَكُمْ لَشَّتَّى. This is مُقْسَمْ عَلَيْهِ, on which, you know, these three ayat of oaths, they prove. Just as the difference in the day and the night, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَخْشَى وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا تَجَلَّى. And the difference between the male and the female, وَمَا خَلَقَ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى. إِنَّ سَعْيَكُمْ لَشَّتَّى. Now, this is the most important place in the Quran. Now this, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. As I told you last night, it's like a flower bud. The petals are closed. Here now it is opening. The flower is opening up. And three petals appear of each flower. One is the flower of doom. The other is the flower of salvation. فأما من أعطى واتقى وصدق بالحسنى فسنيسره لليسرى. Three characteristics, three qualities. If somebody has these three, he goes to salvation and success. And if somebody has the opposite of these three, وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ وَاسْتَغْنَى وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَى. Very beautiful. Three verses, three. أَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى. As for him who gives his wealth in charity. This is the most fundamental. In Surah Al-Balad we saw, this is the narrow valley which we have to cross. This is the bottleneck. فَلَقْتَحَمَ الْعَقَبَةِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْعَقَبَةِ فَكُّ رَقَبَةِ أَوْ إِطْعَامٌ فِي يَوْمٍ ذِي مَسْغَبَةٍ يَتِيمًا ذَا مَقْرَبَةٍ أَوْ مِسْكِينًا ذَا مَتْرَبَةٍ ثُمَّ كَانَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْمَرْحَمَةِ. So same is here. If you have this quality that you can spend your money, your wealth for the poor, the needy, the destitute, the hungry, for relieving pain of somebody, number one. Number two, wattaqa. Now the translation you will find, and who is God fearing, but this is not correct here. But the basic meaning of taqwa. Taqa yaqi. Waqa yaqi means to save yourself. Waqa yaqi. Waqina azab an-nar. Oh Allah, save us from the punishment of the fire. Say, waqina azab an-nar. Ibtaqa bab ista'al. And it becomes ittaqa, means to save yourself. Taqwa means saving yourself. Saving yourself from the displeasure of Allah. Saving yourself from the wrath of Allah. Saving yourself from the fire of hell. All this is taqwa. You are saving yourself. But this saving is based on a moral sense within human beings. Alhamaha fujuraha wa taqwaha. You have a moral sense in you, a moral law, according to Kant, you know. He said there are two proofs of the existence of God. The starry heavens above and the moral law within. This moral law, we read this last night. This moral law. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. This knowledge and this distinguishing, this faculty, this ability to distinguish this is good, this is bad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has endued each human soul. So if this moral sense is active and this moral sense is active and alive, so he himself shuns away from evil, tries to do whatever he can do good. This is the basic meaning. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى, number one, وَاتَّقَى. Number three, وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى. This is on top. And then he truthfully testifies to whatever is good. This is the third faculty. You should be ready to accept anything. When somebody presents you something and you think it's good, accept it. Somebody says, brother, you are wrong here. What you are doing or what you believe is wrong. Now you argue with him. And during this argument, you come to feel what he is saying is correct. Now jump at it, accept it. Now if you feel, oh, then I will be defeated. So I'm not going to give in. This ta'assub, zid, This closes the door of goodness for you. But if all these three basic qualities are there, you are saved from the love of wealth, so that eta, you are giving. You are spending your wealth for the benefit of fellow human beings. Vattaqa, and there you have an active moral sense within you. That moral law within, according to the words of Kant, is active. And number three, you have the habit to accept from whosoever it is coming, even if it is coming from your enemy. But if your enemy says something correct, you accept it. Okay, brother, here you are correct, I accept. Let us proceed further. This point you have made. If all these three faculties are joined in a human personality, he becomes Siddiq. Note it. We have read in Suratul Nisa, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. Four levels of people who are bun'am alayhim, who are blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Topmost, Anbiya. Number two, Siddiqeen. Number three, Shuhada. Number four, the righteous, common righteous believers. They don't have any special achievement, but they are righteous, God-fearing, doing good deeds, but no extra achievement. But if somebody rises, there is a level of shuhada. Higher up is Siddiqeen. And next to Siddiqeen is Nabuwa. This last one is closed. Even before, it was God-given. It couldn't be attained by your effort. It was Wahhabi, not Kasbi. But the remaining two are there open to you. And these remaining two, if you want to have an insight, because in Suratul Hadid also we read, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ السِّدِّيقُونَ وَالشُّهَدَاءُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. These two levels are mentioned over there also. They refer to two types of psychological build of the personalities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made different, you know, aptitudes. Some people, in the modern psychology, they call them the introverts, always thoughtful, thinking. Then they have good sentiments. They would like to be alone, not in the company, alone to themselves. They are not very active. They are not visible, running and going there or going here, not very talkative. Introverts, inside them. And Iqbal says, apne man mein doob kar paaja suraghe zindagi. They are diving deep into their own selves. And the other is the extroverts. Their attention is toward the outside world. Enjoying, seeing, going here, going there, talking in the company. They are very, you know, very comfortable in the company. But when they are alone, they feel uncomfortable. But they are active because they are extroverts. So the first category from this come up the Siddiqeen. Abu Bakr was the Siddiq Akbar. Usman Ghani was the second Siddiq. This is a category. But the second category, who fail at the third level, Saddaq Abil Husna. This third quality is not very deep in them. So they take time. They take their time to understand. Umar took 6 years to understand what Muhammad is saying. Hamza took 6 years. But they were active. They were wrestlers. They were fighters. When they entered the fold of Islam, Islam got strengthened. So these are shuhada. More active, visible, more effective. But closer to the Anbiya are the Siddiqeen. That is why Imam Razi has said that this surah is the surah of Abu Bakr. And the next surah of Duha and Inshirah, they are the surahs of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Surah Al-Layl, Surah Abu Bakr. Surah Al-Duha, Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these three qualities. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. We shall gradually make him more and more able and suitable to reach the place of greatest ease, and that is the garden of paradise. If you have these three qualities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take you gradually, 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 nearer, 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 nearer to the garden of paradise. But if you have the three opposite qualities, وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ, whosoever is miserly, he loves wealth more than anything. وَاسْتَغْنَى, and he pays no care. لَا أُبَالِي, فَلَا أُبَالِي, I don't care. They don't feel for others. They have taunted on somebody. And they don't think that I have hurt his feelings. No. What to me? I don't care. All these type of people. The reverse of attaqa. The moral law is very weak within themselves. And number three, top of that, وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى. When something good, some truth is presented before them, they belie it. Although their heart has accepted, it is correct. وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ. In their hearts they believed, but with their tongues they belied. So this is just the opposite. Whosoever has all these three, is the worst of the people. And the model of this character in that Arabian society of the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, society of Makkah, was Abu Lahab. The top there is Abu Bakr. The top there is Abu Lahab. In between you will have grades. Grades of the believers, grades of the disbelievers. Among the disbelievers were Abu Jahl, but Abu Jahl was not miserly. This was not real. He's above that. We shall read that surah, which we may call the surah of Abu Jahl. But he didn't have that moral law. Number two, he didn't have the ability to accept the truth when it comes to him. So he failed. But he was not miserly. So you will find others between these two extremes. So you will find in this surah two words, Ataqa and Ashqa. Ataqa, topmost muttaqi. Ashqa, the lowest wicked. The lowest in wickedness. فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَىٰ. Whosoever has these three qualities, we shall gradually make him more able and suitable to reach the place of greatest distress, that is the fire of hell. وَمَا يُغْنِي عَنْهُ مَعْلُهُ إِذَا تَرَضَّىٰ. And his wealth shall not be able to avail him of anything when he will be thrown headlong into the hell. إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا لَلْهُدَىٰ. Verily, it is our responsibility to show the path. To give guidance is our responsibility. And we discussed three levels of this guidance. One is the instinctive guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to everything. The ant knows how she has to live, how she has to feed herself. The bee, the honey bee knows everything. How she has to go to the flowers and collect and suck, you know, and then how to deposit the honey. This is guidance. Allah sent revelation or wahi to the honey bee. So instincts, they are also guidance. Man has also instincts. This is the guidance. Number two, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon man the ability that he can differentiate by himself between evil and good. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَىٰ. With these two things we have come in this world. We have come here not blind. Allah has given us these two faculties. But then the final guidance comes through the word of Allah, which is transmitted to humanity through, number one, the Rasul-e-Malak, to a chosen person from among the human beings, Rasul-e-Bashar, and that is the link of Risalah, and this is the final guidance. Inna alayna lal-huda. Yes, this is our duty. Wa inna lana lal-akhirata wal-ula. But then, we hold the total authority of Akhirah as well as the Ula, the hereafter as well as this world. We don't share our authority with anybody else. This world is running according to our command. And we shall judge people on the day of judgment. لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. So, فَانْزَرْتُكُمْ نَارًا تَلَزَّى. Now the Prophet is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so my community, my people, I have warned you of the fire of flames. لَا يَسْلَعَا إِلَّا الْأَشْقَى. None will enter it but the most wretched. Why the most wretched? The highest level of guidance has been completed on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those people who are not accepting it, even from Muhammad, they are the worst. شَرُّ الْبَرِيَّةِ الَّذِي كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. Who belies the truth and turns away. وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى. Far removed from it will be the most cautious, God-fearing and conscientious person. And who is he? Abu Bakr. أَتْقَى. الَّذِي يُوتِي مَعَلَهُ يَتَزَكَّى. Who goes on giving his wealth to purify his self. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He spent everything. His capital when he accepted Iman on the call of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 40,000 dinars. Spent everything, each and every penny. And when he was going for Hijrah, accompanying Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whatever was there in the home he took, left nothing for his family. The father, he was a blind person, Abu Qahafa. He embraced Islam only after the victory of Makkah. He came, asked the granddaughters, Aisha and Asma, radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, has Abu Bakr gone? Yes, Baba Jan, gone. Has he left something? Yes. And they gathered some pebbles, you know, in a handkerchief. And said, yes, this is the money that he has left. And he, you know, because he was blind, touched with the hands, okay. But there was not a single penny left. All the money he had already spent purchasing the slaves who embraced Islam and were being tortured, one by one, six. And whatever price Their masters demanded, he paid. Bilal was number one, Abu Fakih number two, Zunaira, a concubine, and so on. Allazi yuti ma'lahu yatazakka. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ بِنْدَيْمَةٍ تُجْزَى. And it is not in recompense for a favor done to him by anyone. If he is doing some good to somebody, not because he had done some good to him. No, no. He doesn't have any burden of any good done to him by anybody else, which he has to repay. No, no. إِلَّا ابْتِغَى وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْعَلَىٰ. He is spending all this for nothing but to get to seeking the pleasure of his Lord, the Most High. فَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَىٰ. And definitely he will be pleased. Now this goes both ways. He who? Allah will be pleased, and also he will be pleased. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُمْ. Now the third surah of that subgroup. سورة الضحى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى صدق الله العظيم. This surah has an event behind it in the background. That is when the wahi started coming to Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. After a number of wahis, then there was a sudden cessation of wahi. Jibreel is not coming. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam till that time had developed such an intense love for wahi. He became dejected, sorrowful. Let me use the modern word, depressed. And this depression of his reached the level of suicide. Suicidal tendencies. Even today they say, this is the biggest sign of depression. If depression reaches that level, then it must be treated. Otherwise, shorter than that, go on with it. You can go on, continue. He himself says, several times this idea crossed my mind, I should mount, ascend a mountain and throw myself down. So much grieved. What has happened? Allah has become angry with me. I have offended him. Has he left me? There's a saying in Persian, Ishqasto hazar badgumani. When there is love, then you soon become suspicious. Maybe my beloved is angry with me. The more you love, the more is this possibility. So that was the condition in which this surah came. And he said that Umm Jamil, the aunt, paternal aunt of, no, yes, yes, paternal, met the wife of Abu Lahab. She said, oh Muhammad, it seems your Satan has left you. Still rejoicing. Now he has to add injury to insult, insult to injury. He had to listen to these things also. In that condition now this surah is coming. And these two surahs, Suratul Duha and Suratul Inshirah, they have been fully understood only by the people whom we know, whom we call the mystics, the Sufiya. Although I don't like this term, they have understood these feelings within you. And there, in these two surahs, Allah is talking to his, with his messenger at a very, very personal level. Very personal. Very close. وَالْدُحَىٰ by the morning brightness. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَىٰ and by the night when it is still and calm. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَىٰ. Your Lord has not forsaken you, nor is He displeased. Now the oaths, and what is the connection between What is the muqsam alayh? On what the oath has been taken? Oh, Muhammad, you see, there's a difference between night and day. But both are essential. Can anybody say that night is not necessary? This life in this world would cease to exist. Day is also necessary. Night is also necessary. So the coming of day is also necessary. And some pauses and some delays and some cessation is also necessary. So that you develop. Now there is generally people who have some creative role in the world, creative role, who create something new. They have this experience. At times they say, mood off. But what is it, this mood off? Even they can't explain. At times they are very active. At times there is inshirah. And at times it is inqibaz. As if something, you know, has shrunk in your chest. Or as if your chest has widened. These cycles normally go on among the more intelligent people. But you know the cycle, if it remains within certain limits, it's okay. If the amplitude increases, then it is disease, mental disease. Depression and many maniac activity going to the top, mania, and this depression. But you know, in the working of this world, you have to have these two. Ghalib says, now I apologize to brothers who don't know Urdu, especially Urdu of Ghalib. Rukti hai meri taba to hoti hai rama aur. After each cessation, internal cessation, when I come out of that inqibaz or depression, now I have a fresh activity. Enhanced activity, my taba becomes very, you know, active. Rukti hai meri, but there is a time when I feel this, some stop, something has stopped. I can't say poetry. Something has stopped in me. But then suddenly, now when I say, then that is the best poetry. So this is the wisdom of this cessation. This temporary cessation of wahi doesn't mean that your Lord has forsaken you or he has been displeased with you. No. Now these words are also denoting to the same phenomenon. Akhira ula. With every cycle, the coming cycle will be much better for you than the preceding. And the final, the akhirah, the hereafter, will be much, much, much more better for you than this world. So it can be, it has been translated in both ways. Every coming moment of your life will be better for you than the preceding one. And the final future, and that is of hereafter, is surely very, very, very much better than this world. وَلَصَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And very soon, your Lord will give you all and every good in such an abundance that you shall be well pleased. Don't be disappointed. Continue your struggle. وَلَا تَبْنُمْ تَسْتَقْسِرْ. The same thing. وَلَصَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And now in three ayat of this surah, three very important features of the life of the Prophet before the start of Wahi. Alam yajidka yateeman fa'awa. Look to your past. Oh, my beloved servant and bondsman. Look to your past. Did he not find you an orphan? And then gave you shelter? You were born after the death of your father. First shelter was the mother. Second was the grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. Third was the uncle Zubair. Very few people know that between Abu Talib and Abdul Muttalib, there was the elder son, Zubair. Then when he also died, then you know, the guardian was Abu Talib. So he gave you most kind, most loving. All cared for you, all loved you. Alam yajidka yateeman fa'awa, wa wajadaka dhallan fahada. And found you in search of guidance. Dhall means someone who is still searching for the guidance, searching for the truth, seeking the truth. Or someone who was on the right path, but by only mistake, he has gone wrong. Not due to any bad intentions. In Surah Al-Fatiha we have, غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَالْضَّالِّينَ. الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ are those who due to their bad intentions, they turned to the wrong paths. So they had the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over them. And the most glaring example from among the people of the book are the Jews. But the other ones, the Christians, their intention was not wrong. It was excessive virtue in them, excessive virtue. That took the form of Rahmaniyya. So they are dhalin, not maghdubi alayhim. So dhal means a person who either by mistake has come on the wrong path, not due to any bad intentions, or he is still searching for the path, for the right way. And dhal in Arabia, this term is applied to person who is in extreme love for someone. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. And he found you. He was in search of truth. What for you were going to the cave of Hira? Staying there for several nights and days? What for? He didn't belong to any religious group. He was neither born a Jew or a Christian. And you know this. Idolatry and worship of idols, absolutely, it was impossible. Repugnant to him from the very beginning. So what was he doing over there? Intense thought, meditation, contemplation. What is this? What is this universe? Who am I? Where from have I come? Where am I heading? What is wrong? What is correct? And why is this injustice in this world? Oppression. Why this exploitation? Why these inequalities? What? All this thought of a person having a deep philosophical, you know, mind, and at the same time very intensely right-minded person. What is this? So then we found you searching for the truth and good. And then we guided you and our angel came to you and the revelation started. And number three, chronologically it was prior to this. But this is the rhythm of the surah by which you know the sequence is changed. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَغْنَى. And he found you poor, destitute. So he enriched you. From the very beginning, he was very poor. Abu Talib was a very poor person. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to work as a laborer to support him. He was, you know, tending the goats and sheep of Arabs, of the Makki Qarshi people, going out, working hard. And then when he was of some age, then he was working for some rich man as an employee, some rich trader. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the gate for him. the richest woman of Makkah and the noblest woman of Makkah, Khadija. He came to know of the virtues and qualities of Muhammad. He tried him. She tried him. He took a caravan of hers to Syria, came back. And she sent with him a slave of his most confident to watch him, see his dealing. And the report that she received, then, you know, she was tempted to offer herself to be married to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad could never think of it. Many chieftains, you know, of Quraysh had tried to marry her, and she had refused. No. And now, the proposal came from Khadija, radiallahu ta'ala anha. And then Khadija put all her wealth at the disposal of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You spend it wherever you like. I found a story in the Tafsir al-Kabir of Imam Razi, that once the Prophet came, he had gone out and they came back, but he was very much sorrowful and grieved, and he laid down, taking a blanket, something over him. Khadija asked, what's the matter, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, I went out from Makkah, and in that valley I found there is a tribe who have nothing to eat, no clothing, very poor, destitute people. And I don't have anything with which I can help you, help them. She said, okay, get up and call such and such and such and persons of the Quraysh, call them. Muhammad went, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brought them. In the meantime, she had made a heap of the golden coins, so much high that when Muhammad sat behind it, it covered him. And then she said, all of you should be witnesses. I give all this to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is free to spend it anywhere he likes. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. He found you destitute, poor, needy. And he made you, enriched you. فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. So now, three commands. As for the orphan, don't oppress him. فَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. And as for the beggar or the questioner, sa'il, two meanings. Somebody comes to ask a question from you. He's also a beggar, beggar of knowledge. Somebody is asking for some dollars or some money. He's a beggar. But don't be harsh to any questioner, any beggar. سَائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. وَمَا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And as for the blessings of your Lord that have come to you, proclaim them. Announce them publicly. Now this has a vast meaning, you know. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with, you should say, my Allah has blessed me with this thing. My God has blessed me with this thing. That is why the Prophet used to say, although he was very humble, very humble, very humble, no haughtiness ever touched him. أَنَا سَيَّدُ وُلْدِ عَادٌ بَلَا فَخْرٌ. But he had to say this. I'm the sardar or the chief of all the progeny of Adam. But I'm not saying it with fakhr. No. And so on. نُسِرْتُ بِالرُّوبِ. أُوتِيتُ جَوَامِ الْكَلِمِ. And so many things of that type. And the second meaning is that the biggest blessing on you is this Quran. You convey it, proclaim it from the rooftop. Let it be known to the people. Propagate it. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.